Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and ladies and gentlemen. Actually, it is a great pleasure and an honor for me to be here with you today, and I would like to thank the organizers for giving my organization, which is the Forum for Agricultural Research in Africa, the opportunity to be with you today and to serve in this August panel. Now, I have actually a PowerPoint that I have prepared, and the topic for discussion is GMOs and biotechnologies in different geographical contexts. And actually, I would like to state that I'm not very sure this is my presentation, is it? I would like to state that my presentation will concentrate on non-transgenics, and I will focus more on Africa. And then I would again like to inform the gathering about the fact that transgenics over the years have attracted quite a lot of controversy. And I believe that the controversies are centered actually around issues related to safety, human health, and environmental health. And I think that in Africa, we do have another concern, a concern that is related to the use of these seeds by GMOs, particularly by farmers who are smallholder farmers, resource-poor farmers. And the problem there is the risk of having to pay for these seeds, you know, and this is very unacceptable, you know, to those farmers. Moreover, I would like to state that we have not in Africa fully exploited the potentials of the modest biotechnology tools, tissue culture, anticulture, marker-assisted breeding, etc. These are viable tools that could be used to produce improved varieties. And so we need to exploit the potential of these tools. You know, as we continue the discussion, you know, surrounding the controversy of GMOs, and moreover, what is happening in the world today is the fact that you talk of biotechnology, people perceive it to be GMOs, whether it is anticulture products that are got from anticulture, tissue culture, people just say it's GMOs. And I think that the fact that we're thinking more of genetically modified organisms or products, you know, is masking the potential of these modest biotechnology tools like tissue culture, anticulture, marker-assisted breeding. And I think that it is our responsibility in the research field, in other domains, to try to create awareness, you know, so that we don't link the two together. GMOs are GMOs. These other tools are other tools that are that can be used, and I believe that I should be able to prove this, that can be used, you know, to address other key issues that constrain agricultural development. For example, the if we look at biotechnology in Africa generally, you will find out that we have exploited some of these tools, and I believe that I will be talking later on about the Nerica rice, the new rice for Africa, which I championed, you know, to develop. And at the same time, we've exploited other tools to produce clean materials. When I say clean materials, that are free from diseases, through tissue culture, et cetera. But the GMOs themselves, themselves remain controversial in Africa. And today, although some countries have ratified what we call the biosafety laws, the biotechnology regulations have only been ratified in 6 countries in Africa. And only 3 countries are cultivating GMOs at commercial level, and that is South Africa, Egypt, and Burkina Faso. And the crops that are being cultivated are really very at a very narrow range. For example, cotton is being cultivated in Africa, maize, soya, and canola and sugarcane. These are the crops that are being cultivated. But then, as mentioned by the chairperson, and the fact that we are running into problems concerning climate change, I think that we need to mobilize productivity-enhancing technologies, whether it comes from modest biotechnology tools, or whether it comes from GMOs. And in that regards, I would like to discuss a key project that I was part of. I led that project, and it centered actually on rice, mainly because rice is becoming a key crop commodity for Africa. In fact, the demand for rice has been growing, particularly in the last 15 to 20 years. And again, we also note that the increase in rice demand is in the region of something like 6 to 7% annually, so much so that the continent imports 40% of its rice requirement. And basically what that means is that Africa today, you know, accounts for 32% of the world trade on rice. And it means that we are spending something in the region of $4 billion to import rice into the continent, where we do have the facilities, the land, the water, et cetera, to produce enough rice for ourselves. And so this project involves, in fact, I should mention that there are 32 species of rice, 22 species of rice worldwide. 20 of these species are wild species, and then 2 are cultivated species. The cultivated species, one originate from Asia, which we call the Oryza glabrima, that is the botanical name, but I would just call it Asian rice. And then the other one is indigenous to Africa. It originates from Africa, and it is called Oryza glabrima, that is the botanical name. Now, these two rices from different geographical background, for 50 years, attempt was being made to cross these two types because they do have some favorable characteristics. The Asian rice have got high yield potential because they have secondary branches on their panicle. The African rice is low yielding type, but because they've existed in Africa for over 3,500 years, that's the period for which they've been domesticated, they've developed adaptive or protective mechanisms that enables them to withstand some of the key constraints to rice productions in our various ecologies. Resistance, tolerance to key stresses, ability to suppress weeds, et cetera, et cetera. So our intention was to cross these two types, the Asian rice and the African rice, to combine into a new type of rice that we succeeded in developing, and now we call it Nerica rice, to combine the high yield potential of the Asian rice and the adaptation of the African rice into this new type of rice. And I must say that we succeeded in doing that, and we did that through conventional back crossing, which you can see on the screen now. I've just come to the part of my PowerPoint that I'm very familiar with. We do that through conventional back crossing, and the back crossing, maybe later on I can explain that, you know, actually allows for the combination of genomes of the two types, combination of genes of the two types, the Asian and the African type. And we also followed the back crossing with anticulture technique. It's a modest biotechnology technique. It is not genetically modified a product that we got out of this. And these two, back crossing and anticulture, enable us to overcome some of the key problems that are associated with interspecific breedings of rice types, Asian and African type. It enables us to overcome the frequent sterility, because when you cross these different species, you run into sterile grains. We overcome that problem. It enables us to overcome the slow fixation of the line. You have to, when you cross, your line segregates, and you have to get to fixation. And it's with interspecific breeding, we go from generation to generation, and it's segregating. Anticulture enables us to stabilize the land so that they become varieties. And most importantly, it allows us to ensure that we get, solve the problem of low recovery of recombinant lines. You want to see combined genes of the two types, Asian and African, in the new products that we produce. So we were able to overcome these problems. And actually, the new Nerica rice that we developed combined these characteristics. And I would like to say that it combined these characteristics. And from the sativa rice, that is the Asian type, what did we get from the sativa rice? I would like to concentrate on that. We retain the high yield potential, usually under upland rain-fed situation, average yield in Africa is 1 ton per hectare. Our yields are very low, you know, but with the Nerica rice, you can get up to about 2.5 tons per hectare in traditional cultivated system, where there is little or no use of external inputs like fertilizers, et cetera, et cetera. So it does well under low input system, but with application of fertilizers, with improved management practices, yields can go up to what you see on the screen, which is about 6 tons per hectare. And why did we get this increased yield from this interspecific product? It is because I mentioned earlier on that the sativa rice have got secondary branches. Now we got what we call in breeding transgressive segregation, you know, from the interspecific lines that we produce. Transgressive segregation is when the offspring does better than the best of the parents. You know, so basically what happened in our own case, not only did we get secondary branches on the panicle, we also get tertiary branches on the panicle. And the grains are attached to those tertiary branches. So basically, these interspecific lines that we produced, you know, we are able to get something, as you can see from the screen, the panicles, big panicles of about 400 grains per panicle. Compared to the Asian type, which is the best of the two species, that gets a maximum of 250 grains, or the African type that gets a maximum of 180 grains. So there is transgressive segregation there. But basically, another major trait that we got from the Asian type, the Oryza sativa, is non-shattering of the grain. The African rice will shatter their grains so easily, so that before you get to maturity, you've lost about half the grain on the panicle. So we retain that characteristics in the new types that we produce. But what did we get from the African rice, the Oryza glabrima? We got weed competitiveness. I could not show you the slide, but there is a slide where the glabrima is growing, that is the African rice. It's a solid mat in the field, so it just smothers the weed. So that particular characteristics was transferred into the Nerica rice. Ability, and this is due to droopy lower leaves, particularly during the vegetative phase, that suppresses the weeds. You know, then another thing that we transferred into these new rices is tolerance to a range of stresses. Increased level of resistance or tolerance to drought, increased level of resistance or tolerance to diseases, the key diseases that we face, but at the same time, we retain the tastes and aroma, good taste and aroma that the African consumers like. But there are other characteristics that we transferred in these rices. We never envisaged this when we carried out the interspecific breeding. And this relates to higher protein content. The ceiling for protein content before the development of Nerica rice was something like 8% protein content in any variety of rice. But we were able to increase this to something like 10 to 10.5%. That is 25% increase in protein content. Another characteristics relates to the duration. Normally, if you cultivate traditional varieties in Africa, minimum of 5 months to 6 months through the grainy season is what you will get. And for improved materials, minimum of 4 months to 5 months. But the Nerica rice, we're given something like 90 days. 90 days from seed to seed, from the time you plant to the time that you harvest. And the advantage of this is that you'll be able to actually grow 2 crops of rice in a given rainy season. But we don't want to advise farmers, particularly in upland situation, you know, to grow 2 crops of rice. So what we want to advise farmers is that you grow one crop of rice and another crop of legume. The legume will add nutrients, phosphorus to the soil, and it will make your next rice crop to perform better. You know, so these are some of the characteristics. So we succeeded in getting a new type of rice that we call Nerica. Nerica is new rice for Africa. It is not the, it's a new type, and there are several varieties. It's not just one variety. So to cultivate the Nerica in your area, you need to test a range of Nericas to find those that are adapted to your situation. So what did we do? After we found out that yields are very high, and yields can be stable because they have this range of resistance or tolerance to stresses, we wanted to scale up the Nerica. So we came up with an idea of what we call the participatory varietal selection work. Participatory varietal selection work bring everybody in the value chain to test the materials, to evaluate the materials, but particularly the farmers taking the lead to select the best material for their own fields. You know, and so the farmers were in the driving seat of that boat. You know, and because of that approach that we took, today, after about 5-10 years in some areas, Nerica rice is being cultivated in about 1 million hectares of land in Africa. And in 2008, the FAO, FAO, which is here, indicated that rice production increased in Africa by 18%. 18% in 1 year, that is in 2008. And basically, the reason for that they gave was because of increased cultivation of Nerica rice. So if we are able to spread this to all rice growing areas, we believe that, and if we continue to increase production like we did in 2008, we believe that in 4 to 5 years, we'll be able to double rice production in Africa from something like 14 million metric tons that it was in 2008 to something like 28 million metric tons. That will enable Africa to virtually feed itself and at the same time maybe to export rice to other continents of the world. And again, what is happening in different countries? If you look at countries like Uganda, that did not know rice 15 years ago, after adopting the Nerica rice, today Uganda is saving something like 30 million US dollars, funds that otherwise would have gone into the importation of rice in that country. And on top of that, they are exporting to the tune of 12 to 15 million US dollars to neighboring countries, to Kenya, to Tanzania, et cetera, et cetera. A farmer in Guinea said, since I started cultivating this Nerica rice, this is a subsistence farmer, now I produce enough to feed my family for a whole year until the next planting season, and I have enough extra rice to sell so that I can take my children to school. So basically, we're beginning to see this kind of impact in a number of countries in Africa, which we thought is really very impressive. So you don't have to go to GMOs. These other technologies can give you reasonably high-yielding, stable materials that we can plant. And Africa is exploiting that, not just for rice, but for other crop, for bananas, for pineapples, and we are using tissue culture to come up with a range, increased number of viable materials for planting that can give fairly high yield. Ghana adopted tissue culture to produce pineapples, mass production of pineapples. And today Ghana is number 3 in the export of pineapple to Europe, you know, behind Costa Rica and Ivory Coast, Cote d'Ivoire. You know, so these, sorry about that. So these technologies can be very effective in producing improved varieties. It doesn't have to be genetically modified product. But what is the way forward? Mr. Chairman, I just have about 2 slides. What is the way forward? The world must increase awareness of biotechnology. It's not all biotechnology tool that is used for GMOs. It's not all biotechnology product that is GMOs. Just like what I've just explained with in Erica Rice, we need to know what it is. We need to know what are the risks and what are the potential benefits. And this is where my institution actually comes in, because they are looking at that. My institution is taking actually a neutral, is playing a neutral role in this, because we are the forum for agricultural research for development in Africa, and we have to satisfy all countries. And we believe some countries would like to grow biotechnology products, others would not like to grow GMOs. And so we want to work with believers and non-believers so that we can come in with surveys once in a while to find out what are the problems, if there are any problems. We haven't seen any problems to date. And so why should your people starve, even if you have GMO products that will save them? And at the same time, we are promoting stewardship in biotechnologies in Africa. We've trained quite a range of people that are going out, in fact, 106 to be exact, that are going out to train others in biotechnology tools. We need to use biotechnology to address the policy problems and marketing problems that hinders adoption of what I would call productivity-enhancing technologies, whether from conventional approaches — such technologies may come from conventional approaches and from other approaches. And at the same time, is this working anymore? Can you? Okay. Well, we need to promote partnership. Public-private sector partnership actually is very important. For example, we have an institution in Africa that they call AATF, African Agricultural Technology Foundations. And what they do is they broker such technologies from institutions like the genes from institutions like Monsanto, and with international institutions like Increasat, and they come up with promising varieties, like high quality protein maize varieties, like water efficient maize varieties. We need to build capacity of our people to be able to exploit the potential of biotechnologies, whether it is GMO for GMO purposes or not. And we need to make sure that our institutions have the facilities, and because most Africans are very patriotic. They will stay and do their work if they have the resources to do their work. They only go out when they don't have the resources. So we need to retain our scientists in Africa, you know, to undertake the work. I'm not sure this is — can I have the next one, please? And the next one, please.
Next slide.
Yeah, okay. So, ladies and gentlemen, that is the end of my slide. And sorry, Mr. Chairman, I went over by 1 minute. I see that I've done 21 minutes instead of 20 minutes. But thank you very much for your patience.